سيدي ويا مولاي يا رسول صلى الله عليه وعلى آل بيتك المعصومين المأمومين. صلى الله عليه يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله المسلم يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة. ما خاب الله من تمسك بكم وأمنا من نجأ إليكم سادتي. يا ليتنا
chapter of Al-Nazi'at, chapter, verses 40 to 41. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in these beautiful verses, He says, and as for he who prevents himself from following his whims, his carnal desires, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward him with eternal paradise. Eternal paradise. صدق الله العلي العظيم آمنا بالله صلى
الله على محمد
صلوات على محمد وآل محمد. This is a good sign, because the only way that we know that we're technically there is when we have technical difficulties. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So yesterday we spoke about the importance of crying and how it is that crying really shakes our very being and causes our soul to literally quake to the point where we feel that our heart is squeezed so hard that the only way that we can express our emotions is through crying. And that each one of those tears is a tear of regret. Each one of those tears symbolizes a wish that we could have fulfilled, right? And we said that Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi as-salatu was-salam, what does he say? He says that كَثَى بِالنَّدَمِ تَوْبَةً, that if one regrets, that is sufficient repentance if one were to regret. So every tear that falls from our eyes would be a tear of repentance. Now today our goal is to build on that concept, because we said that we wanted to shake up our hearts. We wanted to be able to express this awakening that we're trying to have, the spiritual awakening in the days of Ashura, through the tears that we shed. And we showed how important the tears are in the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so much so the Prophet cried, right? The Prophet cried, we said, before, during, and after the Imam's birth. Therefore, it's Sunnah to cry. We showed in the Holy Quran that the Prophets cried. When we spoke about the ayah of Prophet Ayyub alayhi salam, how he cried for his son Yusuf, for Prophet Yaqub alayhi salam, when he cried for his son Yusuf until his eyes turned white. So crying is sanctioned by Allah, right? It's from the Sunnah of the Prophet also. Today what we want to do is we want to build on that. Now how we're going to build on that is we said each one of those tears literally is shedding the sins, shedding the sorrows, shedding the regrets, so that we can open up our hearts, allow our hearts to be open to reform, to be open to change. Really, each tear then becomes a call to action, right? And that's what we want to build on today. But in order to understand how we can take actions that will reform us and change us to become better people, to become more religious, not just religious as a title, religious in action. And Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says, كُنُوا دُعَاتًا لَنَا بِغَيْرِ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ. He says, call people onto our way without your tongues, through your actions. And we've all heard the famous words, right? Where we say, a picture is worth a thousand words, right? A picture depicts an action, right? So we need to be people of action. Now, how can we be people of action? We have to understand the inner workings of our very being, of our very existence. In order to do so, we have to first and foremost look at our own existence. What composes it? And then we have to look at these components really seriously and try to figure out how is it that they interact with each other normally. And then what we want to do is we want to understand how is it that we can affect these components such that they can be effectors of action, right? They can be the type of components that will allow us within our very being and very existence to live Husayni lives, to be as men Husayniyun, or as women Husaynabiyat, right? Not to say that as a woman you can't be Husayni, of course you can. You can be Husayniya by being Zainabiyya. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So at the end, what I'd like to do is give it kind of a practical approach, right? A practical approach to see how it is that we can actually do so every day, right? Practically, not just leave here and just have a bunch of theory, okay? Because sometimes it becomes hard to work with the theory. We don't know how to put the practical, the action with the words, with the theory, right? So let's start off first by defining what are the components that consist of my very, very being, right? What are they? First of all, I know of my physical existence. You say, Jeff, now I know, you know, I'm a physical being. I have DNA, I have cells, right? I breathe through my lungs, right? I have a liver, I have kidneys, so that's me. And there's a label on my forehead. I come from a lineage, right? And whatever my dad and mom named me, correct? Right? That's my physical existence. But there is something beyond that. And we know, we kind of have an idea, because we dream. We know that we see things in dreams, and dreams aren't physical, right? They're metaphysical. We also know that we feel emotions, and emotions aren't anything you can really grab, right? You might express an emotion, and we see happiness on your face or sadness on your face, but that's only really a natural body response to the metaphysical reaction that you're having inside. So your physical body starts to depict your emotions, your metaphysical feelings, how? In a chemical way. And that is depicted through your body language, through the tears that you shed, through the anger you show on your face, the grimace, right? Now, we've recognized the physical body. We need to understand also that we are also made of a soul. And of course, all of us Muslims understand that there's a soul. Of course, this is a point of argument when we talk to atheists, but we know, as believers in Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the soul, right? Now, we also know that we're composed of the nafs, also known as the self. And we also know we're composed of the qalb, known as the heart. Not the physical heart, it exists where the physical heart exists, but in the metaphysical realm. We also know that we, other than the heart, other than the nafs, other than the ruh, we also have the power of the intellect. We have the power of this imagination, and the power of desire, and the power of anger. Now, that's how many things, that's about seven more things than we have existence within us other than the physical existence. That means really we should pay more attention to our metaphysical health than our physical health. Not to say we shouldn't pay attention to our physical health, of course, right? Since Allah gave us these bodies, it's a trust that Allah gave us, and therefore we need to take care of them. We need to feed them nutritious foods. We need to make sure that we're healthy and we're exercising, right? This is a trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us. But now that we understand what these components are, we need to define each one of these components. That's the next thing that we'll do. So let's look at the soul. The soul is known as a ruh in Islam. A lot of people say, well, what is a ruh? We know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defines a ruh in the Holy Quran. He says, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنَ الرُّحِ قُلِ الرُّحِ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. They ask you about the ruh, the soul. Tell them that this ruh is from the world of command. It's from the command of Allah. Now what is command? What is this world of command? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains in the Holy Quran. He says, إِنَّمَا أَمْرُهُ إِذَا أَرَادَ شَيْئًا أَنْ يَقُولَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He wants something to happen, all He has to do is say to it, be, and it shall be. Right? So if Allah commands something, all He has to do is say what? Be, and it shall be. So this is the world of command. So that means that the soul is created by Allah by what? The world of command. And the world of command is be and it shall be. Therefore, the soul is created by be and it shall be. But what? We said we're composed of the physical body also. How does that come about? The physical body comes about in the world of creation, known as the alam al-khalq. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has two worlds for us, right? Through which we have our existence. One is the world of the command, be and it shall be. And the other is the world of khalq, وَلِلَّهِ الْخَلْقُ وَالْأَمْرُ. Allah says in the Holy Quran, the world of creation. And this is how, for example, a couple get together, they have a baby, right? The baby grows in a certain way in his mother's womb, and then childbirth occurs. Or a seed is planted in the earth, with the right soil, with the right nutrients within the soil, with the rain, with the sunlight. What happens is we have a beautiful plant that starts to sprout with beautiful two leaves that come up as though in dua towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this beautiful plant grows to have flowers, and those flowers are pollinated to give us fruits, right? Or vegetables, depending on what you like to grow in your backyard. And then what happens, right? We're outside with our kids picking these fruits or these vegetables, and we're enjoying them and we're eating them. And what happens to their seeds? Their seeds are later placed in the soil, and the cycle of life, the cycle of creation, continues. This is the system of the world of creation that Allah has given us. Okay? So then we have the world of, we're composed of the world of Amr and the world of Khalq. The next thing I need to understand is the Ruh is a dynamic being. The Ruh is fluid. Now, how do you contain something that's fluid? How do you tame it? How do you hold it down? In comes the nafs, the role of the nafs, the self. The nafs is an anchor that holds the soul to its physical body. So the connection that connects the metaphysical to the physical is the actual nafs. It's the glue, the anchor that holds the ruh to this physical world. And when it does so, what happens in turn is it's very highly connected to the materialistic world. And because it has that connection with the materialistic world, it has materialistic tendencies. I hate to tell you, right? And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِسُّوءٍ. Surely the nafs commands you to do ill. Why? Because it commands you to fulfill your desires, your worldly materialistic desires. You see? Not your metaphysical desires, your physical desires. And that's why it commands you to do evil. Now, we understand the soul, we understand the self. Now we need to understand what's the effector, what's the influencer that's going to help us to make the right decision, right? That is al-qalb. Al-qalb, or the heart. It's called al-qalb because it turns, يتقلب من القرار الرحماني بين القرار الرحماني والقرار الشيطاني. It turns between making the right decision that brings it closer to Allah, the divine, the sublime, or that decision can turn into the wrong decision, a decision of disobedience that pushes you farther away from Allah and deeper into evil and sin. Right? So that is al-qalb. The qalb is where a decision is made, and it is where the decision settles. And once the decision settles in the heart of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi afdhal as-salatu was-salam, what does he say? He says that once that decision is made, إِذَا كَانَ قَرَارًا رَحْمَانِيًّا, if it was a decision that brings you closer to Allah, then the heart of the believer is brightened with the nur of Iman. Iman. So the right decision brightens my heart with the nur of Iman. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, to complete this part of the narration, he actually says that that ruh of Iman, that bright light that brightens the heart of the mu'min, is also supported by ruh al-Iman. And once one makes a satanic decision, a decision that brings you farther, takes you farther away from Allah, a disobedience, what happens? The heart darkens. Why? It's exactly like when you go into a room and someone turns the lights off, right? When you turn the lights off in a room and you walk around, are you more likely to bump into things? Yeah. Is it easy to make the right decision to know whether to go right or left? Is it? In the darkness? When you see nothing but pitch black? Of course not. It's very hard to make a decision. The heart is the same way. If we make the wrong decisions, darkness takes over our hearts. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the Holy Quran, He says, كَلَّا بَرَّانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ. Says, no, surely a darkness takes over their hearts. Now, keep in mind, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very merciful. We'll see how it is we can move this darkness. Now, once I make a decision, it's exactly like doing what? Turning on the light switch. Once I turn the light switch, everything becomes clear. Right? I can see everything around me. Just through making the right decision. And we know that when one lies, it's easier to lie again, right? And then it becomes easy if one steals the first time, a tiny little thing, becomes easier to steal something bigger, right? But just the same way as it is easy to make a wrong decision, it's also easy to make the right decision. It's not actually harder. It's shaitan that makes it seem as though it's harder for us. It's because the shaitan whispers to us, right? Tries to influence us. He tries to influence us before we make the decision. He influences our nafs, he influences our heart. Now the next thing we want to talk about is the intellect. We mentioned the heart, we mentioned the nafs, we mentioned the soul. We want to talk about what is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us to be able to influence the heart into making the right decision and push the self away from influencing the heart. And that's the intellect. And if you haven't heard the hadith before, the very first hadith in the book of Al-Kafi, one of our four books of hadith, one of the oldest books of hadith that we have, that goes back to the time of Imam Al-Hujjah, ajallahu ta'ala farajah, during his first ghaibah, Al-Allama Al-Kulaini in his book Al-Kafi, the very first hadith in Kitab Al-Aql, he says, لما خلق الله العقل, when he first created Al-Aql, the intellect, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala استنطقه, gave it the ability to rationalize and think and speak. And what does he say? What did he say to him? He said, أقبل فأقبل وأدبر فأدبر. So he told him basically, turn around, let me fill my eyes with you. Well, proverbially, of course, Allah doesn't have eyes. Let me admire you, right? So Allah is admiring His creation. He says, وَعِزَّتِي وَجَلَالِي إِنِّي مَا خَلَقْتُ خَلْقًا أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِنْكَ وَمَا أَكْمَلْتُكَ إِلَّا فِي مَنْ أُحِبِّ. He says, surely by my grandeur and my majesty, I have not created a creation more endeared and beloved to me than you, for and neither have I completed you except in those whom I love. So if I want Allah to love me, then I have to work very hard on perfecting my intellect. Right? So very easy formula. It's not complicated. And what does Imam Ali tell me in this hadith? He says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, He said, فَإِيَّاكَ أَمُرْ وَإِيَّاكَ أَنْهَا وَإِيَّاكَ أُعَاقِبْ وَإِيَّاكَ أُثِيبْ. He says, it is you, O intellect, that I command. It is you that I forbid. It is you that I punish, and it is you that I reward. See how important the intellect is in Islam. So then the intellect is very important. Important in doing what? In gaining the knowledge that will allow me to affect the qalb. How? What are the things that affect the qalb? There are the remaining three powers. What are they? The power of imagination, the power of desire, and the power of anger. Now we notice in normal developmental behavior of children, our kids, when we're seeing them growing up, right? The first thing that they tend to do is they tend to collect information. Right? They collect the information of what they store in their hard drive, their brain, right? And what happens? They collect colors and height and length and softness and roughness and so forth, right? That very first stage of learning, a Sheikh al-Mudaffar, in his book of logic, he says this very first stage is an important stage. This is the stage where the child collects information. He says in the second stage, he calls it the comparative stage. He says in this stage, the child starts to compare. He can notice Islam has developmental psychology right there, right? The first thing we learn in Hawza, logic, the first thing in Mantaq al-Mudaffar, the logic of al-Mudaffar, is the stages of learning. And he says in the comparative stage, a child starts to compare. Oh, this is rough and this is soft. This is high and this is low. This is dark and this is light. This is red and this is orange. So there's a comparison that occurs in the mind of the child, right? The next stage is called the imaginative stage. You know when your child starts to imagine having friends that aren't there? Imaginary friends. Or they're playing with their toys and their games and they're living in a world that's completely imaginary that you can't see, right? And they're talking to themselves just today, right? I was going up the stairs in my house, and what do I see? I see my daughter, Zahra, just talking to herself, playing with her toys, and she was in a totally different world. She wasn't with us, right? But see, it's the culmination of all of these that helps in the fourth and last stage of learning. And that is called the complete stage. Sheikh al-Mudaffar calls it the complete stage. العلم الكامل مرحلة العلم الكامل أو التكامل. Here, what happens is that the child now starts to take all the information they stored in their hard drive, starts to take all of the comparisons they made, right? Starts to take all of that imagination, and in the imaginative phase, they start to realize emotional attachments. Before, emotional attachments were instinctual. Just like when a baby cries, right, for their mother, And they can tell from the smell of the mother, right? From the touch of the mother, the feel of the mother, from the voice of the mother. Now it's no longer instinctual. Now they understand what love means. They understand what sadness means. They understand what anger means. And in the final stage, they take all that information. And when they're faced with new information, what happens? They start to analyze the information, form solutions, and form conclusions. Right? So then, the intellect, it develops, right? It develops. Now, how is it that these three powers, remaining three powers, the imagination, become a liability for me? And how can I turn them into an asset as opposed to a liability, right? Because most of us, if we don't have the right knowledge, what happens? And we see this in the kids, right? In the examples that I gave. That if we don't have knowledge of reality, what happens is we start imagining our own reality. So I start thinking, oh, I'm handsome, right? I'm so smart. I'm so beautiful, right? And the next thing that happens after I imagine these things is I have a desire to be noticed, right? And what happens is in the desire of being noticed, what am I doing? I'm seeking attention. So what might I do? If I'm a guy, I might laugh out loud. Or I might, you know, show my presence by puffing up my chest and speaking out loud. If I'm a sister, I might express it maybe in what clothes I wear or how I walk. Or, a woman might carry a Louis Vuitton bag, for example. Or, you know, drive the latest car, right? She can't be in a car that's less than a Benz. Hey, why? Don't you know who I am? I'm a beautiful woman, right? And beautiful women need to be taken care of, right? So the husband has to put a house in my name and a car in my name, and they have to be the latest I need. The house has to be at least 3,500 square feet, huh? And the car has to be the latest Benz, correct? Not used, has to be brand new out of the dealership, right? Don't laugh, guys. You guys too, I'm about to get you now, okay? And the guys, of course, right? What do? Now, when they're younger, they work very hard in the gym, you know, because their entire ego is in their muscles, is in their biceps and their guns, right? And of course, they have to have the Mustang or the Camaro, right? Has to be also leased, even though it's going to put a dent in their pockets or their dad's pockets, right? They don't care. They're not paying. They just need to look cool, right? No, and in college, the first thing they tell you, well, I'm in med school, and they're still not even first year pre-med. Right? And the parents, right? They want their kids to be doctors. So when you ask them, what is your child studying? They're like, Ibn al-Hasib al-Tawdi. Right? Right? He's not even there yet. He hasn't even finished high school. But they're imagining, right? It's not bad. It's not a bad sort of imagination. Don't get me wrong. But it's not reality yet, right? It's what we want our reality to be. You know, there's a beautiful narration that helps us solve everything. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says it beautifully, Hajj. You know what he says? He says, "Don't think of tomorrow and a future that will never come. You don't know if it's going to come. You have no guarantees. And don't think of a past that will never return. Think of now." And what you're going to do now with yourself. That doesn't mean don't plan your future. That's not what the Prophet is saying. What he's saying is, don't live in imagination. You see, our futures are based on every second that we take and every breath that we make, right? So every action that I take now, literally, is a milestone towards achieving my greater goal. So I'll set my greater goal. So when Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi afdal salatu wassalam, sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. When he says, live your life as though you will live forever, right? Correct? Isn't that what he says? Right? And he adds to it, he says, but you know, make sure that you also live your life like today's the last day of your life. How am I going to do that? That's like a catch-22. Right? How am I going to do that? How am I going to do both? There's only one way. There's only one way. I have to not live on this extreme or that extreme. I have to live in the middle. Right? I have to live in the middle where I'm doing all my ibadat as much as I can right now, right? And I'm also making sure that my materialistic gains are realistic gains, right? Are gains that please Allah. You know, Imam Ali alayhi afdal salatu wassalam, you know what he says? He says that the meal that you eat, when you eat, he says, give a third to water, a third to food, and a third for air. And what is extra remaining in your plate, that's not yours, that's for someone else. He teaches us how to break down our time. He says, a third for you, a third for your Lord. Right? And he says, a third for your work. So a third for your family of your time, a third for your Lord, and a third to make a living. So live a balanced life. Right? And he says, anything extra that you've made in your wealth that's beyond what your needs are, Allah didn't give it for you. He gave it to give to others who are in need. How many of us live like that? I'm sure all of you do. I'm preaching to the choir, as they say. So now, how am I going to get to that point? Allah gives me a simple solution. And we'll see how modern psychology, how this matches with modern psychology. You see, when I make a decision, humans are animals of behavior. You know, we establish behavioral patterns from a very young age. Even Imam Ali alayhi afdhalus salatu wasalam says something really beautiful that really is congruent. It's completely in line with what psychologists and neuropsychologists teach us today. Neuropsychologists say that within the first formidable years of the growth of a child, from 0 up to about 4 to 6 years old, their neuronal pathways, the interneurons, are being formed. And everything that a child is taught sticks. It's engraved in their mind. Imam Ali, what does he say? He says, "Al-ilmu fi al-saghri kan-nakshi fi al-hajar." He says, teaching a child, learning at a young age is like doing what? Carving in stone. Notice how what we learn matches with what Ahlul Bayt teach us. Also, what we learn from Imam Ali alayhi afdal salatu wassalam, he says, listen, if you want to control these four powers, what you have to do is take baby steps. He says, قَلِيلٌ مَدُومٌ عَلَيْهِ أَرْجَى مِنْ كَثِيرٍ مَمْلُونٍ. He says, I want you, us Ahlul Bayt, what we ask you, what Allah wants of you, is not to do boot camp style dua and worship. Okay? That's not required of you. Right? Because even if you're going to do that, like Laylatul Qadr for example, right? You're going to do that once a year, and then what happens the rest of the year? Are you boot camping it? Or are you too praying, getting up for morning prayer is like hard enough to pray 2 rak'ah. Right? Praying your dhuhr and asr prayer in the middle of the day while you're working, you're like, I'll delay it. Right? Imam Hussein salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi didn't delay in battle. Amir al-Mu'mineen didn't delay in battle. Right? We're not in battle. We're just working our everyday lives. Right? And yet we delay. We delay. Why? Because Amir al-Mu'mineen says, he says, أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُم مِّنْ أَمْرَيْنِ. I fear for you from two things. اتِبَاعَ الْهَوَى وَطُولِ الْأَمَلِ. Following your whims and procrastination. He says, أَمَّا اتِبَاعَ الْهَوَى فَيَصُدُّ عَنِ الْحَقِّ. As for following your whims, it prevents you from the truth. وَأَمَّا طُولِ الْأَمَلِ فَيُنْسِي الْآخِرَةِ. And as for procrastination, oh, I won't do it today. I'll do it tomorrow. I won't wear my hijab this year. I'll wear it in 2 years. Right? I won't go to Hajj this year, even though I have the money and the wealth. I'll go next year. Who knows if we're alive next year? So he says, what? What does procrastination do? Makes you forget the hereafter. Makes you forget that you could die at any time. And that there's a day of judgment. And we do this every day. All of us do this. Not just the ones that don't consider themselves religious, even the religious. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses the religious, the believers first and foremost in Surah Al-Hujurat. Look at the verses. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا يَسْخَرْ قَوْمٌ مِّنْ قَوْمٍ عَسَىٰ أَنْ يَكُونُوا خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ وَلَا نِسَاءٌ مِّنْ نِسَاءٍ عَسَىٰ أَنْ يَكُنَّ خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَلَا تَنَامَزُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ بِئْسَ الْإِسْمُ الْفُسُوقُ بَعْدَ الْإِيمَانِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what does he say? He says, O you who believe, let not a people make fun of another people. And let not women make fun of other women, lest they be better than them. And don't divulge your secrets, and don't call each other names. Name calling is haram. He says, بِئْسَ الْإِسْمُ الْفُسُوقُ بَعْدَ الْإِيمَانِ. Surely it is a terrible, terrible, terrible state for one to be in, to fall out of a state of belief into a state of corruption. Fusuq. A mu'min becomes fasiq when he makes fun of other people. becomes facet when he calls other people's name, other people names. Why? Why do we do such things? Because what happens is Shaitan comes in and whispers to us, right? He tries to influence our decision. If our intellect is weak, what happens? Our intellect is affected, right? How? It's pushed down. And when it's pushed down, what rises? Imagination. Becomes like Shaitan. Right? خَلَقْتَنِي مِنْ نَارُ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ طَيْنِ You created him, you created me from fire, you created him from clay. Well, I mean, if you thought logically, we know that clay puts out fire, but he's not even there. Why? Because he is so proud. Right? He imagines that he's better than the one who Allah said, prostrate to him. And we do this every day. Allah tells us, remember me. What do we do? We say, no. I follow myself. Actually, I follow the football game. Let me watch a little bit of football. Actually, you know what? Let me just finish typing up this message on Facebook. Let me finish WhatsApping my friends, right? Let me finish, you know, the NFL game on my Xbox, right? Let me finish watching, I don't know if anybody watches soccer here, but let me finish the soccer game and then I'll get up for prayer, right? Everything becomes more important than Allah. I procrastinate. I follow my whim. You heard that whole saying in the West, we say, oh, I did it on a whim. Why did you do it? Oh, I did it on a whim. How does that happen? You see, whim is very, very dangerous. How does falling into following your whim happen? It happens when the intellect is weak. Now you might say, but Shaykhna, you know, I've gained a lot of knowledge about Ahlul Bayt over the years. Why is it that I still keep sinning and my life is full of disobedience to Allah? Say, because you see, there's a difference between knowledge and belief. Al-ilm wa iman, two different things. Now the intellect will collect information for you. You'll gain information, and what will happen? It'll be archived in your hard drive. Remember how we said about the stages of gaining knowledge, right? And that's why we see, for example, a doctor who tells you, don't smoke while he smokes. You see him in, you know, behind the building, for example, during his break, taking a couple of puffs, right? If smoking is bad, why are you smoking, right? Or someone who's smoking and comes to you, smoking argila, and says to you, Khalo, don't be like me. Don't smoke argila, it's bad for you. Didn't you see the billboard next to the ICA? It says one puff is equal to 1,000 cigarettes. Right? Am I right or no? Yeah. Right? And yet, Khalo, why are you still smoking? Didn't you say it's bad for me? If you believed it, then you should have done it. So we see the youth smoking. Right? And we wonder why he's at the local argila place during the month of Muharram or the month of Ramadan. You know, a great marja in Najaf, one year we had a delegation come and visit him. And I asked him, I said to him, you know, Sheikh, now what advice can you give the parents? He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it such that your actions are more profound than your words. And Allah says this in the Holy Quran. He says, Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu. He addresses the believers. لِمَ تَقُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ Why do you do that? Why do you say that which you don't do? كَبُرَ مَقْتًا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَن تَقُولُ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ Surely it is hated by Allah for you to say those things that you don't do. So if you're going to tell me stop smoking, then you need to stop smoking too. So I'm going to take you seriously. Right? Right? Or a father who says, listen, I'm going to take your Xbox away from you, and he's playing with the Xbox, and it's time for Salah. And don't tell me that doesn't happen. I know it's happened. I've seen a few cases. Okay. So, how does this happen? See, the intellect is composed of an ability to gain information, and then the intellect needs to be affected by a state of iman. How does that state of iman occur? When I value the information that I get. Once I value the information that I get, what happens? I believe in its importance in my life. And what will happen? I'll be committed to it. Just like I know in the Dearborn or Greater Detroit area, riding a bus is not feasible for us Arabs. Right? It's not feasible. No self-respecting Arab will be seen riding a bus. I don't know why. Right? So what do? We understand the value of a car. And we believe in its importance. So, what do? We get the best rims for our car, we make sure that it gets a great oil lubin filter very regularly, right? Or the husbands have to do that for the sisters, right? And then what happens? I, have a great car that's well maintained, that, you know, has a good warranty on it, that has insurance, and I can go back and forth comfortably because I believe in the fact that it is of value to my life, so I'm committed to taking care of it. The same thing, of course, with our brothers who are married. They believe in the value of their wives, so they take care of them. So they only make the wife hear good things. Ya Habibti, Ya Ba'd Galbi, please do this for me, please take care of that for me. Of course, the husbands only talk this way to their wives here, right? So this is very important. This is important to be part of the understanding that in order for us to make sure that our intellect is effective, that we believe in the value of the religion that we have. How can we do that? Through Tawheed. Through Tawheed. Through proving and affirming Allah's existence. That's why Imam Ali salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi says, أَوْلَدِينِ مَعْرِفَتُهُمْ, that the first of religion, if you want to consider yourself to be religious, the first of religion is to know Him. وَكَمَالُ مَعْرِفَتِهِ التَّصْدِيقُ بِهِ, and the completion of knowing Him is to affirm His existence, right? To affirm His existence. To say, I am able to prove God exists. وَكَمَالُ التَّصْدِيقِ بِهِ تَوْحِيدًا, and the completion of affirming Allah's existence is tawheed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَكَمَالُ التَّوْحِيدِ لَهُ الْإِخْلَاصُ لَهُ. وَكَمَالُ تَوْحِيدِهِ الْإِخْلَاصُ لَهُ, and the perfection of having tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what? Is having sincerity towards Allah. That's why we see in the verse that we started with, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the solution. He says, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى. As for he who recognizes the status of his Lord, and therefore does what? Prevents himself, the self, from falling into following its whim, from falling prey to its imagination, and therefore falling prey to its desire, and therefore then falling prey to its anger, just like shaitan. You see, that's how I'm going to protect myself. Now you say, well, Shaykhna, that's all good and well, but practically speaking, how am I going to do it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers that question for me very beautifully in the Quran. He says, وَسَبَّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ قَبْلَ طُلُوعِ الشَّمْسِ وَقَبْلَ غُرُوبِهَا وَمِنْ آنَاءِ اللَّيْلِ فَسَبَّحْ وَأَطْرَافِ النَّهَارِ. He says, listen, what I want you to do is do what Imam Ali is telling you, قَلِيلٌ مَدُومٌ عَلَيْهِ أَرْجَى مِنْ كَثِيرٍ مَدْلُودٍ. Right now, in the now, be in the now. Don't talk about the future and what you're going to do. Don't think about the past. Psychologists say if you think about the past, you're going to fall into bad behaviors, repeat your past patterns of behavior. And psychologists also say, don't look too far ahead. Work on achieving your goals today and right now. There are even apps for this. So I suggest to you, look, there are apps. Download them. I have a couple of apps. Right? You want to be better at exercising? Get yourself a Fitbit. I'm not paid sponsorship by Fitbit. Okay? I'm just saying, if you want to become stronger in exercise, better in nutrition, understand how many calories should go into your body and how much energy you should expend, right? You should use the tools. Today we have the technology for that. In the old days, what we had was this. Tasbih, masbaha. Right? What do we do? What Allah tells us in the Holy Quran? Oh, remember Allah, exalt Him, do tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before sunrise, before sunset, in the middle of the night. Fasabbih. Remind yourself of Allah, mention Allah. Say, but what about, is it just tongue service? No, let me finish the verse, don't interrupt me. Okay? Allah continues in that verse, what does He say? He says, and the ends of the day. So when aren't you doing tasbih? When are we not remembering Allah? Remembering Allah always, every single breathing moment. And therefore we can be in the now. So we say, well, Shaykhna, how am I going to do that? There, like I said, there are several ways. One way is to try to consciously and willingly recognize that time is not yours. Time is a creation, and everything that is created has a beginning and an end. Are you going to say, Shaykhna, how am I going to remember that every single breathing moment? The Quran tells you, it tells you, listen, if you just say with your tongue, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, then what you're going to do is literally you're going to be working from the outside in. Notice in the times of Ashura, what do we do? The beautiful narration that we mentioned yesterday, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, salawat. What does he say? Prophet Muhammad says, he says, he who cries for my son Hussein will be given heaven. That will be his reward. Then he says, no, he who sheds one tear for my son Hussein will be deserving of heaven. He says, no, he who pretends to cry for my son Hussein will be given heaven. You'll say, well, Shaykhna, that's fake, right? What do you mean, pretend? See, the Prophet, what he wants to do is he's telling us, he's saying, listen, if from the inside in, from the inside out, you're not ready to express remorse, to express sadness for my son Hussein, to awaken your soul, your heart, then start from the outside in. Okay? That's how you're going to be able to change yourself. You know, modern psychology says you need 36 to 38 days to change a habit. All you need to do is make a small change. Read a book by Charles Duhigg called The Power of Habits. It's a good read. Okay? He says it takes 36 days. If you have a problem biting your nails, all you have to do is when you feel like biting your nails, stick your hands in your pockets. Do it for 36 to 38 days, they say, the psychologists. Okay? You know what Islam says? Islam gives us the holy month of Ramadan, gives us a whole month, 30 days, gives us 2 days of Eid, and then it gives us 6 days that are called the days of bright light. That if you were to fast them, you get the equivalent of years of worship. How many days is that? 38 days, right? But no, we have something called the Pledge of Allegiance to Imam al-Hujjah, ajallallahu ta'ala farajah, dua al-ahd. That is highly recommended to read in the morning of every day. And if you read Mafatih al-Jinan, what do you see? It says, he who recites Dua al-Ahd for 40 days, on that day, 1,000 of his sins will be erased. And on the day that Imam al-Hujjah, ajallallahu ta'ala farajah, reappears, he will be resurrected as one of his servants. Sallu ala Muhammad. So once I realize the value then of my religion, then what will I be able to do? I'll be able to act upon the knowledge that I have, value it, believe in it, commit to it, and instill change every single breathing moment. With every breath, I will remember Allah. If I need an app to remind me, I'll tell you personally, I have an app. One of my apps, I have a morning routine, an afternoon routine, and a nightly routine. And you know, in my morning routine, I actually have pray morning prayer. In my afternoon routine, I have pray, dhuhr, and asr prayer, right? In my night routine, I have the same thing. And in each one of them, I have recite Quran. In each one of them, I have recite dua. In each one of them, I say, gain 5 minutes of knowledge you didn't have the day before. It's easy to do. All of us have apps. Get any app and turn it into a divine app. That doesn't have to be an app that's made for Muslims necessarily, right? But you can do it with any app that has to do with self-improvement. Okay? You can add your own habits. And they tell you, they say, they monitor you. Oh, you did a great job today. You followed, you know, your routine. At the end of the day, the last routine that I have, I even have a time, 11:30, shut off all electronics. Shut off all electronics, man. What's the big deal? And if you have tawfiq from Allah, you put, pray the night. So you see, it's not that hard. And Imam Hussein salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, in these 40 days from the beginning of Muharram to the 40th, that is our program to revive our hearts, to bring us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why, brothers and sisters, we commemorate Imam Hussein. Imam Hussein ruhi lahu fida. Is a constant reminder for the Shia of Ahlul Bayt how important it is to connect ourselves with Allah. How important it is, brothers and sisters, for us to speak for the truth. But first start with ourselves. Know one brothers and sisters was greater that than Imam Hussein. No one brothers and sisters was greater of reminding himself and the believers around him of Allah and the Prophet of Allah. Brothers and sisters, I want you to come with me back in history. We'll go to the time of Karbala. I want you to imagine with me the nights of Karbala. Imagine with me the plains, the heat. Imagine with me what kind of resolve and grit Imam Hussein had to have to take his family with him all the way across from Mecca, Medina, Mecca, and then all the way north to Iraq. How many days, brothers and sisters, did it take? How much water was expended on the way? How many children cried, calling out to their father, Imam Hussein? But would it stop there, brothers and sisters? No, it wouldn't. For when they would get to Karbala, brothers and sisters, instead of meeting those who would come to their aid, instead what they saw was a land that was empty, a land that had no mercy, a land of true Karbala. Brothers and sisters, when they would set camp on the land of Karbala, little did the children know, these pure souls sitting in the land of Karbala, what their fate would be, brothers and sisters. And Imam Ridha alayhi salam, it is narrated that one of the companions, salawatullahi wa salamu ala al-Ridha, would come to him and he would say to him, as he saw him in the days of Muharram crying and weeping for Imam Hussein, he'd say to him, why is it that you cry? Surely you know that this is normal for you. Dying martyred is normal for you, O Ahlul Bayt. He said to him, dear companion, I know that that is the case, but have you ever heard in the history of Islam of the women of the holy household of Allah with their children dragged, tortured, enchained, dragged through the deserts across to Sham? Did this ever happen in Islamic history before or after the tragedy of Karbala? Brothers and sisters, imagine, if you will, what it is like. You know, when we travel from city to city in the cars, our children cry. They cry for food, they cry for relief, they cry. Imagine what it would have been like to be on horseback and to walk across towards Kufa and to be diverted to Karbala, to nothing but arid desert. And then, to top it all off, to lose your family, and then to travel, brothers and sisters, across the plains, all the way to Sham, north. Where? For tourism? No. For humiliation? So that all the people would see the women of the holy household of Allah paraded like POWs, and this is what people thought they were, brothers and sisters. People were ignorant, they had no knowledge. They actually thought, brothers and sisters, that those who were paraded into Sham, as they moved from city to city, people asked, they said, who are these people that are coming in? They'd say, oh, this is our Khalifa Yazid. He had a great battle, and they defeated these evil oppressors. Brothers and sisters, can you imagine the oppression? Can you imagine the ignorance? Can you imagine how the women and children had to manage in such a state? Brothers and sisters, can you imagine when you this young child, I see so many young children here with us, the age of this little girl, you see her, you hear her asking, Hamata, Aina Abi Hussein? Ummah, Aina Abi Hussein? Uridu Abi Hussein? I want my father Hussein, she said. Amma Zainab,
I want my father to say. Finally, from hearing her complaints and her whining, asking for Imam Hussein, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, they would bring her the head of the Imam Hussein. She didn't know. She was thirsty, she was hungry, they bring her a bowl, it's covered. She takes it, excited. Is this water? Is this food? Brothers and sisters, ajarakumullah, when she reveals, she removes the veil off the bowl, what does she see? She sees the hand of her father, Hussein. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Al-Hussein, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. This is how he would see his daughter, Umayya.
Zainab alayhi salam, she would stop hearing the voice of Umayya. She stopped complaining. She thought she was fine now. She would say, Bunayya Ruqayya, daughter Ruqayya, are you okay? Al-Imam al-Sajjad, Al-Imam al-Sajjad would say, Amma, dear auntie, move her away. He didn't tell Sayyidah Zainab what had happened to Ruqayya. Lady Zainab and the daughters of Imam Hussein would rush towards Ruqayya. She was still, they would hold her, shake her. Ruqayya, wake up, Ruqayya. Are you okay, Ruqayya? Ruqayya was dead, brothers and sisters, from the shock of seeing Imam Hussein. Imam Hussein, your father, this is the last meal she got. She quenched her eyes with the silence of her father, Hussein. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Wasayalam alladhina dhalamu ala bayti rasulillah ala ayyim qalbin yanqalib. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين وعلى الذين بذلوا وجهم دون الحسين.
Allah, we ask you and we beseech you, Ya Allah, we ask you and we beseech you that you enlighten our hearts with the knowledge of Hussein. Ya Allah, we ask you and we beseech you that you soften our hearts with the love of an Imam Hussein, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we ask you and we beseech you that you help us become of those who sacrifice, just as an Imam Hussein sacrificed, Ya Allah. You know, these majalis are very important for the youth. I see many of them who have actually shed tears. Very young boys, very young girls crying. You know, when we're older, it's easier for us to imagine things. But when young kids can relate to the story of an Imam Hussein, alayhi salatu wassalam, then you should keep them in these majalis. Make sure that they contribute to these majalis. Oh Allah, we ask that these youth, who are the contributors of the future to these majalis, that we spend the time in teaching them and helping them, and even giving them the time to come to the center more and encouraging them by giving them more and more activities to do. Oh Allah, we ask you, we beseech you, that you allow us to be of those who are effectors of change, Ya Allah. To allow these tears that we've shed to be tears of action, after which we will never be the same. Oh Allah, we ask you, we beseech you, that you bestow your mercy on our dearly departed. Oh Allah, we ask you and we beseech you that you give health to our sick, and there are many that have asked for your dua. Oh Allah, we ask you and we beseech you that you support all those in the past who have made these majalis a reality, and today those who support such majalis and those in the future who are continuing to support these majalis. Oh Allah, we ask you and we beseech you that you hasten the appearance of our Imam al-Hujjah, ajalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-sharif, and that you support the founders of this center, ya arhamar rahimin. Wa akhiru da'wana an alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidina Muhammad. Wa al-Fatiha. Wa akhiru da'wana.